Hello class. Today we are going to start up with a new topic in the suspension itself, that is classification of suspension. As in the first video I have discussed about the definition of suspension, advantages, disadvantages and ideal characteristics of suspension, I think you might have a little bit idea about the suspension. Now coming to the classification, in classification you can expect both 2 marks and 5 marks question in your exams. So, we have a wide, I can say more than one we are having the types of classification. First and foremost important classification which you can expect for the 2 marks in your exams is pharmaceutical classification of suspension. As name itself indicates, it is pharmaceutically how the suspension has been classified. So, first classification of pharmaceutical classification example is first one, oral suspension. Oral expression, suspension, whatever you write in the physical pharmaceutics, you have to write it with the equation, graphs, or if you have any examples, you have to give the examples. Until unless you won't give the examples, it won't be eligible. We will say it is not, won't get the perfect marks. So, for oral suspension, you can give the example, a best example, which we, day-to-day life, we are using gelosil, which is the trade name. Otherwise, it is the aluminium hydroxide gel suspension, in the form of suspension we are using. And for the children's, that is for pediatric use, we are using paracetamol suspension. That two example you can give in the oral suspension. Second is externally applied suspension. In external applied application of suspension, you have topical application. In topically applied suspension, example is, again, your trade name is lactocalamine, that is calamine lotion you have. And another one is ophthalmic gentamicin suspension, which is comes in the form of suspension, gentamicin eye drops. This is second one. Third one is parenteral suspension. Means the suspension which we are giving in the form of parenteral route. So example is intramuscularly applied penidur. In the last class I have told procaine penicillin GV, which is comes under the trade name penidur. That is one example. And another example you might have heard, those who are undergone with a certain accident or what, they will take TTE injections. That is nothing but tetanus dioxide's injection. That is also comes in the form of suspension. Other is aerosol suspension. Aerosol suspension, again in the last video I have told example is fluocortisone steroid, we can say. That is comes in the form of aerosol. So this is the pharmaceutical classification of suspension. That is first one. The second one is based on the amount or the proportion of solid content in the suspension has been classified into two forms. First one is diluted suspension, which contains nearly 2 to 10% weight by volume. Here, whenever we have one phase as a solid and other phase as a liquid, we will say weight by volume. So, it contains dilute suspension usually have 2 to 10% of solid particles, weight by volume. Then, the second one example is concentrated suspension. In concentrated suspension, more than 50% of solid particles will be there. That is, more than 50% solid particles, weight by volume of suspension, we can say. This is the second classification. And the third classification is based on the size of solid particles. If you have remember in the definition, I have told the suspension contains the solid particles which ranges from 10 to 1000 micrometer. Okay. Here again, based on the size of the solid particles, suspension has been classified as colloidal suspension, in which the particle size is lesser than 1 micron. And the second is coarse suspension, in which the particle size is greater than 1 micron. And the third is nano suspension, as the name itself indicates, nano, it contains the particle size which is less than or usually 1 nanogram. 1 nanogram. And the fourth classification, most important classification, based on the electrokinetic properties of the solid particles which is present in the suspension. Once again I repeat, it is mainly based on the electrokinetic properties of the solid particles which is present in the suspension. The suspension has been classified as flocculated suspension and deflocculated suspension. So, in the yesterday class itself, I had told what is flocculation. What is flocculation? I had told the formation of flocculation is nothing but flocculation, the process. Then you may think that what is flocculation? Flocculation is nothing but the aggregation of smaller particles. Smaller particles aggregates into the group is nothing but flocculation. So, one suspension has been classified as a flocculated suspension and the second one is deflocculated suspension. Usually, in exams, you may get a question, differentiate between the flocculated and deflocculated suspension, both for 2 marks as well as for 5 marks. So, as per that, I will explain what is flocculated and what is deflocculated. In flocculated suspension, intentionally we are flocculating the particles by addition of flocculating agent. What are those and all mechanism we will study in the next topic in the formulation. Just here for your knowledge, it is flocculated suspension. Here we are intentionally producing the flocculations by the addition of flocculating agent. Deflocculating agent, we are not adding the flocculating agents. So, it is deflocculated. How will be the, we will start with the physical appearance. How will be the physical appearance of deflocculated suspension? Deflocculated suspension have pleasant appearance. Pleasant appearance. That means all the coarse particle has been dispersed uniformly throughout the container. So, it have pleasant appearance. Whereas in flocculated suspension, displeasant appearance we will see. It is not pleasant. That means the as we are adding the flocculating agent, the flocculating agent settles down and you will have a clear supernatant layer. The second, the amount of supernatant, the amount of supernatant liquid or volume is high in deflocculated, whereas in flocculated it is low, we will say. And the rate of flocculation, we will say the sedimentation. Flocculation is different from sedimentation. Flocculation is the process of aggregation of smaller particles and formation of a bigger particle is flocculation. Whereas sedimentation is the process of settling down of the particle is called as sedimentation. So, I think this point is clear. Sedimentation is different, flocculation is different. So, the rate of sedimentation in deflocculating agent is slow or lesser. Whereas in flocculating suspension, the rate of sedimentation is high as we are intentionally flocculating the agent. Flocculations will form, so sedimentation will be high. So this is one. And after sedimentation, that is after sedimenting, that is settling of the particles, the cake which is formed, that is the sediment which is formed, is hard. That means hard cake will be formed in deflocculated suspension, whereas in the flocculated suspension, the settling of particle is fluffy. That means in between we have a gaps. So, it is fluffy. So, in deflocculating suspension, as the sedimentation forms hard cake, it is difficult to redisperse. it is difficult to redisperse. Why? Because it forms a hard cake. Whereas in the flocculating suspension, as the sedimentation is loosely packed, the redispersion is easy. And in deflocculated suspension, it will have shorter shelf life. That means it will have shelf life means expiry period of the suspension. In deflocculated suspension, it will have shorter shelf life. Whereas in flocculating suspension, it will have longer shelf life. But coming to the bioavailability, in deflocculated suspension, the bioavailability is higher. Whereas in flocculating suspension, the bioavailability is lesser. If the same question asks for 2 marks, mainly you have to write the sedimentation is slow in deflocculating, flocculation high, it form hard cake, it will form loosely packed sediment, redispersion is difficult in deflocculation, easy in flocculating. Main point is shorter shelf life of deflocculating suspension, whereas longer shelf life in flocculating, whereas bioavailability is greater in deflocculating and bioavailability is lesser in flocculating. So, example of deflocculated suspension is usually the paracetamol or the powders which comes in the dry form, then the later the physician will instruct you to add a fixed amount of water, boil and cooled water, make up the volume and use within 1 week. So this is about the classification. Briefly I will summarize. Classification, one is pharmaceutical classification. Second, based on the amount of solid particles it contains. Third classification, we did based on the what? Based on electrokinetic properties of the solid particles we have done. So these are the few, and the one more classification we did based on the size of the solid particles. So totally we have covered 4 classification of suspension. Thank you.